Good evening and welcome. I'm Vanessa Hoffman, Program Coordinator for Research and Education at the Bladder Cancer Advocacy Network. Tonight we present Debunking Myths About Nutrition and Bladder Cancer. For some quick housekeeping, take a look at the left-hand side of your screen. We're using Citrix GoToWebinar. You have the option of listening in using either a telephone or your computer microphone and speakers. Click the circle next to the one you want. You should see the phone number to call in. You should also see a questions box on the bottom right of the GoToWebinar box. Please type in your question as you think of it. It's best if you can ask questions that are related to this webinar specifically. We will be answering as many questions as we can at the end of the webinar. Also, this webinar is being recorded and will be available on the beacon.org website and YouTube channel within the next 2 weeks. Again, the number for Citrix GoToWebinar tech support is 888-621-0537 if you have any technical issues. I would like to introduce our distinguished speakers now. First, we will have Colonel and Dr. Stacey Koff, who is a staff surgeon at Fort Belvoir Community Hospital in Fort Belvoir, Virginia. She's also a fellow in integrative medicine at the University of Arizona. She has a lot of experience in urology and also nutrition. Next, we will have Debra Rowland, who is an oncology dietitian at INOVA Alexandria Cancer Center in Alexandria, Virginia. She is a certified board specialist in oncology nutrition. Lastly, we will have Dr. Ashish Kamat joining for the question and answer session at the end of the webinar. He is associate professor in the Department of Urology, Division of Surgery at the University of Texas MD Anderson Cancer Center in Houston, Texas. He's also a graduate of the American Urological Association Leadership Program and co-chair of the International Bladder Cancer Network. He's authored numerous publications, been listed in the best doctors in America, and has an active clinical practice. So let's get started. First, I will transfer over to Dr. Koff.
I was saying, I'm not sure if I'm aware of too many myths related specifically to nutrition and bladder cancer, but there are certainly many myths and misconceptions about nutrition in general, which I think can tie into bladder cancer risks and possibly prevention strategies. To set the stage, I want to address the topic of nutrition and research methods. In general, randomized controlled trials are the gold standard in research. In this sort of trial, the intervention, which can be a medicine or a supplement or, say, acupuncture, is applied in a random manner to some participants in the study. The others, called the control group, do not get the intervention. In some cases, a placebo or a sham of some sort is given to some of the participants. And then after a time interval, results are compared. You will see that randomized controlled trials are rare in the field of nutrition and bladder cancer, or nutrition in any cancer. It's impractical to get large groups of patients to be compliant with dietary changes, to follow the dietary interventions for long periods of time, and it's difficult to even know if the correct nutrient or dose is being used for the trial. It is almost impossible to have a control or null set of patients who aren't taking in any of the nutrients. So most of the information about nutrition in cancer is derived from epidemiologic studies, case control studies, and research using cell lines in animals. So, on to challenging current myths. There is a popular belief right now that the cavemen were doing things right when it comes to nutrition. There is a new trend toward a paleo diet, which encourages folks to eat things that a caveman would be able to have access to. Meats and fish are encouraged with this diet, along with things a caveman might be able to forage, like nuts, seeds, greens, and regional foods. And although I certainly support eating locally grown food, the cooking of meat over fire or high heat that I associate with a sort of Fred Flintstone cuisine, it may have some cancer risks. It turns out that this lovely char found on grilled meats has carcinogenic compounds in it. Epidemiology studies have found a modest but significant association between high meat intake and getting cancer, dying from cancer, and dying in general. When you then take the meat and cook it over fire or high heat, multiple compounds form in that char, including heterocyclic amines, which can be carcinogenic. This does not seem to be the case with grilled vegetables. Here's that word again, the heterocyclic amines, and they are one of the many compounds found in cigarette smoke, which is felt to contribute to the formation of cancer in smokers. Of course, eating something and smoking something are two very different delivery methods, and I don't mean to equate eating grilled meat with smoking. I do want to point out the common compound between the two items, though. I'm likely preaching to the choir when I say to quit smoking. Tobacco cessation has been proven to decrease bladder cancer recurrences and improve outcomes. Additionally, you may want to limit intake of red meat to once a month and consider slower and low-heat cooking methods for your meat dishes. And so the answer to the title question is yes, give up your cigarettes and sort of give up your steaks. Another topic of interest is related to fluid intake and bladder cancer risk. In the health professions follow-on study, those who took in the most fluid, which was more than 2.5 liters daily, were compared to those who took in the least, which was about 1.3 liters daily. Those who took in the most fluid had half the risk of developing bladder cancer as those who took in the least. Just to clarify, I don't mean water here, I mean any kind of fluid. One study found a consistent inverse relationship between bladder cancer and the number of nightly voids, regardless of the amount of fluid taken. So perhaps it was an issue of urinary frequency. So there are about 3 case control studies that supported increased fluid intake with a decrease in bladder cancer, but others did not. But if you believe that transitional cell carcinoma or cancer of the bladder is caused by carcinogens in the urine or sort of a lot of bad humors in the urine, then this idea of diluting the urine and emptying your bladder more often makes intuitive sense. One of my personal misunderstandings about nutrition was the belief that highly colored fruits and vegetables were better, and pale produce like onions, celery, and mushroom had little nutritional value. But the less vibrant vegetables have their place in cancer prevention. For example, shiitake mushrooms are the object of interest currently, as they are thought to have properties that may be anti-tumor, cholesterol-lowering, and virus-inhibiting. They contain a compound called lentinin, which is believed to stop or slow tumor growth. Lentinin is a polysaccharide that can boost immunology response and produce anti-tumor effects. In the same vein, the onion family, things like chives, leeks, and scallions, contain flavonoids and selenium, which are felt to be antioxidants. So enjoy fruits and vegetables of all colors, including white, gray, and brown. Most of the press about fatty acids relates to heart benefits, but this is an animal study on bladder cancer and the omega-3 fatty acids. 44 rats were exposed to a carcinogen with or without the addition of the protective fatty acids. EPA and DHA are the initials for the omega-3, or the good fatty acids. So the rats exposed to the carcinogen and the fatty acids had no infiltrative tumors after 20 weeks. They had no carcinoma in situ, which is a high-grade but superficial bladder cancer. And when they did develop tumors, they were non-infiltrative, meaning they didn't grow into the wall of the bladder and have a much smaller volume than in the control group. These fatty acids are felt to have anti-inflammatory, anti-proliferative, and anti-angiogenic properties. Anti-angiogenesis means it gets in the way of forming new blood vessels, which is a step that's required for cancers to infiltrate and metastasize. These are some of the sources of the fatty acids. So flaxseed is the richest plant source, and fish is the richest animal source. The flaxseed needs to be ground up to release the oil, otherwise it acts just like a a pretty good source of fiber. There's also small amounts of omega-3 fatty acids in other oils and in walnuts and pumpkin seeds. Americans don't tend to have any problem getting in their omega-6 fatty acids, and some are needed. The optimal balance between the two types is really not completely defined right now, but in general, we need to eat a lot less of omega-6 and a lot more omega-3 fatty acids. Okay, last topic. I think for many years, fat was felt to be an inactive form of excess calorie storage. It turns out that adipose tissue, especially what is called central obesity or weight around the middle, can affect immune function, add to inflammation, and can be hormonally active. The effect of obesity is especially notable in breast and colorectal cancer. As a urologist, I can tell you that obesity is also an independent standalone risk factor for kidney cancer. There's a lot that is unknown about fat and cancer, but the bottom line is that cancer has to be fed. In a very simple way to think of it, the more you feed yourself, the more you feed cancer cells. Many of you may already be at a lean weight, but for those who are not, you might want to consider mild, sustainable calorie reduction. Recently, and for the first time ever, a randomized controlled trial that uses just calorie restriction as a treatment for cancer was approved by the Interinstitutional Review Board at Duke University. As I mentioned at the start, the steps to prevent bladder cancer recurrences are not proven by randomized controlled trials, but minimizing your exposure to carcinogens may help cut down on recurrences. Quitting tobacco is the most important way to do that. Diluting your urine, keeping your bladder empty on a regular basis, and avoiding charred meats are also other ways to cut down on carcinogens. You can also take steps to optimize your response to cancer exposure and create in your body and in your urinary system an environment that can retard tumor formation or growth. These steps include eating a healthy plant-based diet with all colors of vegetables and fruits, eating healthy fatty acids, and maintaining a lean weight. Of course, all of these lifestyle modifications can also lead to improved heart health. Thank you for your attention.
All right, well, thank you, Dr. Koff. I will now change it over to Debra Rowland.
Okay. So Vanessa, do I push on show my screen?
Yes.
Okay. And now I can just advance it. Yeah, it works. Okay. Hi, I'm Debbie Rowland. I'm a dietitian at a cancer center, a radiation center in Alexandria, Virginia. I'm a certified oncology specialist. I've been at the Alexandria Cancer Center for 15 years, and I love what I do. So I'm just going to briefly kind of give you some ideas to think about, and some of them will kind of be parallel to what Dr. Koff says. I think the first myth that I like to talk about is that you have no control over this whole situation, that this is something that just happened to you and there's nothing you can do about it, it's just fated. A lot of my information is going to come from the American Institute for Cancer Research, which is an international organization, and the American Institute is just our presence in the United States. And all they do is research cancer and nutrition, and they've expanded it now to include weight management and physical activity. And they looked at the research over the last 30 or 40 years and said that there were four things you could do to reduce the incidence of cancer, that if in the United States we ate a healthy diet, which Dr. Koff talked about, we got at least 30 minutes of physical activity every day, maintained a healthy body weight, and that doesn't have anything to do with Hollywood, it's just by BMI, that means keeping your weight within 19 to 25, and avoiding tobacco products, that we would reduce the incidence of cancer by 30 to 50%. And that cancer survivors should follow the same guidelines as people trying to avoid cancer. But that's significant. That means that we are, it's in our control to avoid about half of the cancers that are experienced in the United States. As far as eating a healthy diet, the AICR talks about a plant-based diet. Dr. Koff talked about that, where at least two-thirds of to three-fourths of the plate are plant foods, fruits, vegetables, and whole grains. And the last one-third or less would be your meat or your protein, beans, nuts, soy, things like that, and limited processed foods. As far as maintaining your healthy weight, it's one of the most important ways to protect yourself from all cancer recurrence. I've already talked about BMI, and you can even find those charts on the back of cereal boxes anymore, but you can Google it and find a BMI chart if you don't know what yours is. But the higher the number of your BMI, the higher your risk is for all chronic disease and cancers included in there. In fact, there was a study on breast cancer survivors where just losing the excess weight reduced their risk of recurrence by 38%, so it was quite significant. Staying physically active, activity does play a role in weight management, because you can lose weight a lot of different ways, but you can't keep it off without activity. But it also reduces that chronic inflammation that increases the risk of all chronic disease, insulin resistance, which causes cancers to grow faster, improves hormone metabolism, and it improves immune function. So activity is critical in your overall health. The initial goal is 30 minutes a day. And typically, the long-term goal is about an hour a day. And that would include not only aerobic activity, but two or three times a week should include some strength training. The second myth that I hear all the time is that sugar feeds cancer. And really, most cells in the body prefer glucose rather than any other food. So if you would eliminate carbs from your diet and just keep fats or protein, the body would find a way to change that fat and protein into glucose, because there are some tissues that just can't use anything but glucose. The problem is when that your diet depends on sugary foods or highly processed foods with high glycemic indexes, because what happens is that it causes such a rapid rise in sugar in the bloodstream that causes a rapid rise of insulin. And insulin's a growth factor. It causes all tissues to grow faster, and that includes cancer tissues. So it also minimizes insulin resistance. And I'm talking about insulin, and you think, oh, that's just for diabetics, but you don't have to have high blood pressure or high blood sugar to have insulin resistance and high insulin levels in the bloodstream, and they are very damaging. So it's not true that sugar feeds cancer. It's not a poison. You can include a modest amount of sugar in the diet. But if your diet is predominantly foods that change into sugar rapidly, that's when it's a problem. And yes, it would increase your risk of cancer or recurrence. What about meat? I think that's already been gone over pretty thoroughly. I'm just going to go over the AICR recommendations. And the AICR, remember, is the American Institute for Cancer Research. There was a study in Europe that just finished probably 5 years ago. It lasted 30 years, and they followed 500,000 people that lived in 10 different countries, so they've got different eating styles. to see what the relationship between meat and cancer was. And it, some of it was kind of interesting. They recommend now that we eliminate processed red meats as much as possible. They're high in nitrates, like Dr. Koff mentioned, and they're high in fat, too. And during that study, as little as 2 tablespoons a day increased the cancer risk by 8 times. And it was dose-dependent, which is hardly ever seen in nutrition research. The more you ate, the higher the risk went. So, you know, if you go to a ball game two or three times a year and you want a hot dog, then have a hot dog, but definitely make it on the rare occasion. As far as red meat goes, and that does include pork, it is not the other white meat, it did show an increased risk of cancer. It wasn't as high as we thought it was going to be, so we don't say you can't have red meat, but we do think every other day is enough, and try to limit the amount to 4 to 6 ounces a day. Remember, it's supposed to be a quarter of your plate at the most. White meat is neutral in the cancer process, as far as this study showed, and fish seem to decrease the risk, probably because the cold water fish includes a lot of omega-3s. But even though white meat's neutral and cold water fish seems to be beneficial, you still need to keep the portion size small, or it displaces fruit and vegetables on your plate, because really, in cancer nutrition, fruits and vegetables and grains, whole grains, are the magic food. If there is a magic food, that's it. So there are a few other things people always ask me about, and one is sugar substitutes, because if sugar, you know, if we're trying to reduce the high glycemic foods in our diet, what can we do instead? Well, as far as I can tell, sugar substitutes are safe. They've been tested and tested and tested. The studies in rats did show some bladder cancer many years ago, but they didn't show up in primates or in people. I always tell people if they want to use sugar substitutes, to just mix them up. Don't only use Sweet and Low, or only use Splenda. Get a variety so you spread the risk out. But if it comes to a regular soda or a diet soda, I would pick diet soda every time. Caffeine. There is no research that I was able to find that linked cancer and caffeine. It might not be advised with some cardiac issues, and in breast health, it does kind of increase the risk of a cystic breast, but that doesn't link to cancer. So caffeine has kind of been cleared. However, moderation is always best, especially if you want to sleep at night. So that brings us to green or black tea, and really the active ingredient in green and black tea seems to be very beneficial in the cancer process for different reasons at different parts in the cycle. Green, black, white tea all comes from the same plant, but the more it's processed, the less of the ECGC they have. So green tea has the most. Black tea has about half of that. And if you can't drink caffeine, you can get both of those in a decaf form. But they definitely have a lot of research to show that they're beneficial, so it might be a good idea to substitute some of the sodas for green or black tea, with green or black tea. Cranberries, I couldn't find any evidence that it was linked with a bladder cancer risk reduction or increase. I know that it's linked to reducing the number of UTIs, but I understand that the mechanism of action is that it keeps the bacteria from climbing up the urethra into the bladder. So it doesn't have anything to do with bladder cancer, I don't think. But garlic is a food that I think everybody should eat some every day. It's very healthy for a lot of different reasons, and for the cancer, it reduces cancer risk for another. And there was some evidence that wasn't real convincing, but it was definitely interesting, that milk can protect in bladder cancer. It's still preliminary. I don't think I would put odds on it, but you know, I think yogurt and skim or low-fat milk products are good for you, just for bone health, for one thing, so, and a good form of protein. So that's all I have to say, and I hope I kind of clarified some of these topics for you today. Most of the information I have given you comes from the American Institute for Cancer Research, so I wanted to make sure you had the website. One of their goals is to promote passing this information on to the people who need it. So they have a lot of pamphlets and information on their website, and if you're not good with computers, they'll also give you hard copies. Some of their educational materials have won awards, so I would highly recommend that you connect with the AICR. I think you would learn a lot from their website and enjoy doing it. It's well done. So thank you so much for inviting me. I enjoyed this opportunity, and I guess I'll pass this back to Vanessa.
All right. Thanks so much, Debra and Dr. Koff. Right now, we will do the question and answer session. So for everyone, if you have questions, please type it in that box in the bottom right of your screen, and we will get to as many as possible. So for the first question, a lot of people have asked, do you recommend any multivitamins? And someone also mentioned that Dr. Donald Lamb has recommended Oncovite, an antioxidant multivitamin and dietary supplement, as a benefit to bladder cancer prevention recurrence. What's the latest thinking on this? So I guess I'll maybe ask Dr. Koff to start, if you can address this question.
I can't see the question. I think what I heard is, do I recommend a multivitamin, and any comments on Oncovite?
Yes.
I do think a basic inexpensive multivitamin is probably a good idea. As much as we all like to eat properly, it's not always possible, and it can sometimes just fill in the gaps of nutrients that we might have missed during the day. I think that I have, you know, sometimes you read stuff that the multivitamins are helpful, and sometimes you read that they're not helpful, but I haven't seen that they've ever been harmful. You know, like I said, just a basic multivitamin that doesn't go over the RDA, you know, recommended daily allowance of any of the of nutrients in them. The Oncovite had some interesting data. It seemed to improve outcomes for people getting BCG when they were getting treated for bladder cancer and carcinoma in situ. And I'm not sure. Really, in my practice, I've only had one person take it. It hasn't, at least in my practice, it doesn't seem to have taken off. I think there is quite a bit of negative press about overdoing vitamins. And perhaps that's why Oncovite, you know, legitimate negative press where there's adverse outcomes, especially vitamin E and things. So it may be that Oncovite has never taken off because of those concerns, but I don't have a lot of clinical experience with it.
Dr. Kamat, do you want to add anything to that? It looks like you might be on mute. Debra, is there anything you wanted to add to that as well?
Well, I agree. I think that as well as we try to eat, not, you know, all of us are, we can't eat perfectly all the time. And I just recommend a regular multivitamin. I think as we get older and we need more B12, so that has B12. Usually the 50-plus vitamins have more B12 in them. And it's just an additional source of calcium and vitamin D, which most of us need a little bit more of those two nutrients. But as far as the evidence, there really isn't a lot of evidence that any of the vitamins and minerals and supplements are going to reduce the risk of cancer. I think there's other reasons for taking them, though. Like I said, B12 deficiency is common in older people, and most of us don't get enough calcium and vitamin D in our diet.
Okay.
Vanessa?
Yes.
Oh, hey. It said you had me muted, and then suddenly that message disappeared. Just wanted to clarify. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, great. So I just want to clarify the Oncovite issue. That was a megadose vitamin that was studied in a randomized crossover study. It was double crossover, so patients got Oncovite or BCG, and then they switched over. And in that study, patients getting the megadose vitamins did have a better response to the BCG than those who were getting RDA. And then in a follow-up study, which was quite large, 500 patients or so, they compared megadose vitamins with BCG to interferon with BCG. And that was presented and published 2-3 years ago. So the Oncovite did seem to have a benefit in patients who took it, and it was almost the same benefit as those getting intravesical interferon. I've used it in my practice, but the formulation has changed quite a bit over the years, and it's mainly because the amount of vitamin A that was present in the initial formulation was the same dose that later on was shown in a larger study to sort of increase or maybe increase the risk of lung cancer in smokers. So there's a big scare at that point. They dropped the dose of the vitamin A. But ever since then, it's just been one of those things where the added benefit of Oncovite, in my mind, doesn't justify the real increased risk of secondary cancers with the high-dose vitamin A that's been then shown in other studies, too. So they were not really bladder cancer patients, but they were lung cancers, prostate cancers that seemed to be increased.
All right. Well, thank you. For the next question, a few people asked about alcohol intake, if there's a difference between types of alcohol related to bladder cancer risk and specifically red wine. Let's see. Debra, can you address this question?
You know, I didn't see anything linking bladder cancer to alcohol. That might be just my ignorance. I mean, in cancer nutrition in general, alcohol is a carcinogen in large amounts with head and neck cancer. It also increases estrogen in estrogen-sensitive cancers. So we do try to keep it in moderation, but I don't know of any bladder cancer specifically, specific risk. But I think it would make sense to just keep it in moderation.
Dr. Kamat or Dr. Koff, do either of you want to add to that?
Go ahead.
To me, from the going over the different stuff about alcohol, I don't see any benefit of alcohol with regards to cancer. I think, if anything, it's a risk of some degree. It does have benefit. The red wine has benefit with cardiac issues, obviously, so I think it has to be individualized. If you're a patient who has cardiac risk or family cardiac risk, taking in red wine may be helpful because the increase for cancer is sort of a small increase, whereas the improvement with heart disease can be more significant.
Dr. Kamat, did you want to add to that as well?
No, that's good. That's pretty much what I was going to say.
Okay, great. For the next question, I'm going to combine two. The first is, can an alkaline diet help prevent bladder cancer recurrence or progression? And do you feel it could be helpful to avoid acidic foods like citrus and tomatoes that can irritate the bladder? Dr. Kamat, would you like to address this one?
Sure, yeah. Now, the whole issue behind acidifying and alkalizing urine is based on the use of chemotherapy along with that process, and that's where that comes in. Because I hear this a lot from my patients, too, and I do believe it's floating around somewhere on the Internet that that's important to decrease recurrences. It's actually only when done in concert with intravesical therapy that sometimes it does help penetration of a few different agents that are used. But in general, just doing that is not going to help decrease recurrences, nor will it accelerate, obviously, unless you're doing one of these high protein ketotic type diets. And even then, it's more an irritative factor, not a carcinogenic factor.
Okay. For the next question, is there any connection between aspartame in soft drinks and bladder cancer? Dr. Koff, would you like to address this one?
I don't think there is. I think the artificial sweeteners have been studied, and there hasn't been an association found that I've seen.
Okay. And Debra, I know you spoke a little bit to this. Do you want to talk about it?
Yeah, they've really had a lot of testing over several decades now, and there's just no evidence that they're a problem with humans. And I just think we need to keep it in moderation and don't use them. You don't have to use them. But I really feel that if you're talking about sodas, which, you know, are one of the big things that uses the artificial sweeteners, a regular soda has such a high glycemic index, I think it's a lot healthier to drink a diet soda or a diet drink of any kind.
Okay. For the next question, first, I know you had Debra, you had mentioned milk when you spoke. Mm-hmm. Somebody asked, I eat dairy products as alternative source of protein. Is this advantageous for me as a bladder cancer patient? Are there any disadvantages? Debra, would you like to address this question?
Well, I know there are a couple studies out that link prostate cancer to a high intake of dairy products, but those are preliminary studies and they haven't been duplicated yet, so I haven't suggested that people reduce out their milk intake. I do like the low-fat or non-fat alternatives because saturated fat is inflammatory, and remember, inflammation drives disease. But I like it because it has a good protein in it. Especially for breakfast, it's a way of getting protein in your breakfast, and especially with the yogurts that have the probiotics added, I think that's another benefit. Specifically for bladder cancer, I don't know. I just saw that the AICR had listed milk as one of those substances that in preliminary studies had reduced the risk of bladder cancer. And I don't think there's much of a negative unless you drink 5 or 6 servings a day because they do have calories. And that would displace other foods in your diet.
Okay, thank you. For the next question, the person wrote, when I researched bladder irritants, coffee and cranberry were both implicated, suggesting they should be avoided. Can you speak to foods that are bladder irritants? Dr. Kamat, can you address this one?
Sure. It's very individual specific. I'll have two patients in a row that say caffeine causes them to get an irritated bladder, and then 5 that do fine with caffeine, some that have the same reaction with spicy food, cranberry. So it's very person-specific. There's no right answer for everyone. if you're drinking coffee and you find that it makes you, you know, have an irritable bladder syndrome, try stopping it, see if it has a cause and effect relationship, and then stop it. But in general, there's no blanket answer as to caffeine irritates the bladder or cranberry juice does or what have you. So it's very person specific.
Okay. For the next question, this person wanted to know about a few different vitamins and supplements, if there's a link between bladder cancer and turmeric, vitamin D, aged garlic, and mushrooms. Debra, can you speak to this at all?
Well, vitamin D is really not a vitamin because about the best source in our diet is fish skin, and most of us don't eat too much fish skin. It's really a hormone that's made in the skin when the sun hits it. But especially where I live in Virginia, and especially after this last winter, we just don't have the sun exposure that we used to. So I do think we need vitamin D for a lot of different reasons, and there does seem to be a decrease in risk in all cancer with adequate vitamin D levels. So I think I always tell my patients to have their primary care run the blood test. All it is a blood test to make sure their vitamin D levels are in the normal range, because I think it's important when you're a cancer survivor to get that done. Garlic, I don't have any experience with. Mushrooms improve immune function, though, and because they improve immune function, they are going to have they are going to reduce your risk of recurrence. They help repair damaged DNA. You know, there's just a lot of things that they're good for, and all mushrooms, even those little white button mushrooms that are in the grocery stores, are beneficial in that respect. And I can't remember the two other ones. One was
The turmeric and aged garlic.
Turmeric is an anti-inflammatory, and it is very beneficial. So include that in the diet. You can sprinkle it in your rice. You can put it over your vegetables. It's very beneficial. And I think it's mostly the anti-inflammatory process. And as far as aged garlic, I'm not exactly sure, but I do know that garlic in general is very anti-cancer. But I don't know the mechanism of action. Sorry.
Can I clarify that a little bit, Vanessa?
Go for it.
So, again, aged garlic was studied in the bladder cancer arena, and it does seem to have some protective effect, mainly in patients, again, who are getting BCG. It's purported to be something related to the NF-kappa-B pathway of inflammation. And the same thing with turmeric. Actually, my lab and some of our collaborators have done work that suggests that in the appropriate concentration and doses, it does have a direct protective effect against the whole TNF-alpha pathway that can be beneficial in bladder cancer patients. The only, and again, I'm Indian and I eat a lot of turmeric myself, so in the diet it's perfectly fine, but in order to get the beneficial effect in patients, you have to take about 8 large pills a day. So it's not a treatment, but in diet and as part of daily intake, it's certainly potentially beneficial, but not a treatment.
Okay. Great, thank you. For the next question, what else can be done to reduce inflammation through diet? Dr. Koff, can you speak to
my computer timed out. Through diet against inflammation?
Yes.
Was that the question?
Yes.
Well, I mean, to me, it's, I think the issues with, sugar intake and the insulin-like growth factor and the processed foods, probably it modify could help with inflammation. Obviously, all the vegetables and fruits, and the healthy protein. I don't really think there's any magic bullet beyond those things.
Okay. Well, thank you. For the next question, it says it's not food related, but the person was wondering if there's any harm in Wi-Fi in a laptop positioned right on your bladder. Dr. Kamat, can you address that one?
Only if it distracts you from when you're driving or doing something like that. No, I mean there's no evidence that Wi-Fi would affect your bladder.
Okay, and someone else just asked if you can clarify the amount of turmeric required to be beneficial.
The amount of turmeric that comes in dietary capsules is very variable depending on which brand and company you use and what formulation they have. It's absorbed best if it's mixed with milk. So in a fatty environment, the absorption is high. And if you look at the average capsules that are available, or tablets, depending on which company, it's roughly about between 2 and 4 grams that you need a day to get any sort of serum levels. Again, I'm not advocating this as treatment. This is what we found in certain studies in bladder and pancreas and other cancers, but it's not something I can recommend as medical advice.
Okay. Well, thank you. For the next question, the person wrote, can you please address vitamin B12 problems with a shorter small intestine after surgery for bladder removal? Dr. Koff, can you address this question?
Oh, it's definitely a known complication after UZ cystectomy and using bowel to reform a urinary system. It usually takes quite a while to become a problem. I can't remember exactly if it's 5 years or 10 years. But the levels definitely need to be checked and follow up as you get further out from that surgery and, you know, replenished if the levels go low.
Okay. And I guess for one last question, please elaborate on the role of vitamin A in reducing bladder cancer recurrence. Dr. Kamat, can you address this?
So vitamin A was the same one I talked about in the oncovite. It was present in oncovite, or is present in oncovite, as beta carotene. And in very high doses, it can have effects on the liver. Some people have shown that it may increase or may be associated with increase in some other cancers. So a lot of the older studies that were done with vitamin A suggested that it might be beneficial. We were part of a center through SWOG that did a study looking at retinoids in patients randomized. It really didn't have any protective effect. So the current thinking is that vitamin A by itself is not protective, and if you use too high a dose, it might actually be harmful.
Okay. Well, thank you. I guess it looks like we have just one more question. Can you comment on vitamin E and bladder cancer prevention? Debra, can you speak to this?
You know, I really can't. I don't usually recommend vitamin E, so I really can't. Maybe one of the doctors could. I'm sorry.
Sure. Dr. Kamat, do you have any thoughts on that?
Sure, yeah. It's very similar to the other vitamin stories that we've just talked about. I think what happens is when you use a single vitamin isolated away from the way nature intended it to be used, it doesn't quite work. It has to be in combination with other healthy diet practices. So when it's been studied just in isolation, or it's been studied just as a lone supplement, it doesn't help. When it's in combination with other micronutrients, both in epidemiologic and longitudinal population-based studies, and even in lab and clinical scenarios, it does appear to be beneficial, but just taking vitamin E No. Mixed in with other vitamins, as in, for example, the Oncovite or the other megadose formulations, maybe some benefit.
All right, well, excuse me. Thank you very much, everyone. That's all the time we have for questions tonight. Thank you very much to our speakers, Dr. Stacey Koff and Debra Rowland, and also to Dr. Ashish Kamat for joining the question and answer session. This webinar is being recorded. It should be available within 2 weeks on the Beacon website. So once again, thank you for joining us tonight, and have a wonderful evening. Good night.
Good night.
Thank you. Good night. Bye-bye.